Welcome to worship on this Good Friday. Good Friday worship is framed by the Gospel of John's story of Jesus' passion, the church's word describing Jesus' suffering from the arrest to the crucifixion. Worship on Good Friday acknowledges our culpability and our passivity as spectators who share a common powerlessness. We are humbled yet made confident through the self-sacrificing love of God in Jesus as the cross reveals the depth of divine love. Good Friday focuses us on Jesus' cross and tomb, grounding our Christian hope in suffering that is real and avoiding a false optimism that denies painful realities. Today's simplified worship begins with alternating scripture readings and song, before concluding with a sermon and a closing song. This is the Holy Gospel according to St. John. Glory to you, O Lord. The governor, Pontius Pilate, brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the religious leaders, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord?
So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him and with two others, one on either side with Jesus between them. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home.
Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they nailed him to the tree?
After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because the Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out.
Were you there when they pierced him in the side? Were you there when they pierced him in the side?
After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the religious leaders, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Sometimes it causes me to tremble, tremble, tremble. Were you there when they laid him in the tomb?
At the end of March, my son texted me a link to John Krasinski's first episode of Some Good News, SGN. I laughed through tears watching it. Few of us are immune to the good feels inspired by grit and compassion. Cravings for good news intensify as disappointments and heartbreaks flow. Because we label events as good or bad, it makes it tough when something like Good Friday comes along. Jesus is betrayed, denied, executed, and buried. None of that is good, except for maybe the tender care his body received before burial. Sometimes, though, a closer look is needed. For instance, Mr. Krasinski highlighted hospital workers on his show, the selfless care given by custodians, pulmonologists, and everyone else to people suffering all kinds of health crises right now, including coronavirus. Also highlighted was a 15-year-old girl named Coco, who was coming home after finishing the final round of chemo that healed her cancer. Of course, the flip side of these two good news stories is that coronavirus demands a lot of hospital workers, and that there is a 15-year-old who had cancer. News is not immune to these complexities. Well, at least human news is not immune to them. Good Friday is no exception. Jesus' death on the cross is chock full of complexities. The cross reveals a lot all at once, and the Gospel of John glories in the intricacy. The cross reveals a God who loves the world so deeply that becoming fragile and fleshy in Jesus was the go-to move. Jesus in the flesh is a mirror for us, reflecting our self-serving moves in the game we make out of the gift of life. Jesus calls out our schemes better than anyone. Jesus knew Judas would betray him and that Peter would deny him. There are reasons that the religious leaders were determined to have him killed. Neither friend nor foe were left unscathed by Jesus' truth-telling when it comes to people we hurt or the way we hurt ourselves. His truth-telling frees us from the prisons that we build ourselves out of our illusions of perfection and invincibility. It's not pain-free, but it is good news. The cross reveals a God who would rather die than raise a hand in violence against those who plot and execute his death sentence. When soldiers came for Jesus, he told Peter to put his sword away, and then he healed the man injured by it. Jesus' message of God's love for the world was so audacious that he was killed for it. He wasn't caught off guard. His ministry of sharing God's unconditional love could not go unnoticed. Self-sacrifice is something we understand when we experience it on our own behalf or hear a good news story about it. Jesus' self-sacrifice reveals God's grace that defies our understanding. The cross reveals God's suffering with us when we suffer. In Christian scripture, especially in the Gospel of John, the power of God is manifested in Jesus. Not responding in violence, Jesus suffered, which means that God knows suffering. We are not alone in our suffering, whether it's self-inflicted or comes out of nowhere. God's light in Jesus shines in the darkness of suffering, shame, and fear, meeting us in the very place where we think we are the furthest away from God. The cross reveals relationships made new through suffering. Jesus spoke with his mother and friend before taking his last breath. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciples whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." Jesus uses his last breaths to reorient his mother and the disciples' relationship toward each other. Everything leading to his crucifixion, healing the sick, exorcising demons, welcoming sinners, feeding the hungry, challenging corruption, exposing greed, everything Jesus did that hung him on that cross is continuous with the conversation that he's having with his mother and his friend. It's the last thing that he does before he announces, "It is finished." He connects his friend and his mother to each other even as he's reconnecting the world that God so loves back to God through the covenant of the cross. Good Friday reminds us that God is in the covenant business. The cross as covenant cradles the truth. The truth about us in the hands of the one who opens his arms to all as he is crucified. God does the heavy lifting of cross beams and sets us free into God and toward each other. Yet there's this tendency to act as if Jesus is going to return from that bit of nastiness on the cross in an incredibly bad mood and hurt the very world that God so loves. We reduce God to a capricious, malevolent taskmaster who requires appeasement, even as we're told earlier in the Gospel of John that God did not send Jesus to condemn the world. Did not send Jesus to condemn the world. My friends, we reduce God to the worst of ourselves, the worst of ourselves that we keep hidden, and the worst of ourselves that ends up on the 24/7 news cycle. But God is not diverted by our lack of will and misguided distortions. The eternal God entered time to reveal self-sacrificial, unconditional love and free us into God today and for all time. Today is Friday, and we can call it good. Today we remember that God's covenant with the world was finished on a cross and sealed by a tomb. Stay tuned for more good news.
Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but the